Hi, welcome to a special event showcasing the film and zine work of the late Charlie Nash. Thank you for tuning in. My name's Dylan Rogers, and I'm on stage here at the Robin Theater, which is where Charlie gave his final public performance. That show took place on August 22nd, 2019, and was performed alongside a longtime friend and frequent collaborator of Charlie's, AJ Glaub. In this program, we're going to hear from AJ, as well as Joshua Barton at the MSU Library, as they discuss Charlie's zine, Queer Magnolia. After that, we're going to be screening the film Charlie produced in 1978 while living in New York, called Against Nature. So let's get moving right along. First, we're going to go to AJ and Joshua as they discuss Queer Magnolia, and that will be followed by the screening of Against Nature. Brief content warning: when we do get to the film screening, there is a bit of nudity and depictions of sex acts. It may not be appropriate for everybody. So sit back, enjoy, and thanks again for tuning in to this special event showcasing the film and zine work of Charlie Nash.
All right, thanks, Dylan, for the introduction. Thanks, everyone who's tuning in for the discussion and archival showcase of some visual artworks by Charlie Nash. Tonight, we're going to feature the film Against Nature by Charlie. It was filmed in 1978 in New York City on a Super 8 camera. We've recently digitized the film directly from the reel. This is going to be the first showing of that video file, so I hope you stick around for that. That's going to be at the end. First, what we're going to do is we're going to take a look inside the special collections at MSU Library with Joshua Barton, zine librarian. The special collections team made professional scans of Charlie's archival works just for this event. So this is all like never before seen stuff, unless Charlie showed you directly. So I think you're really going to like it. Me personally, my name's AJ Glaub. I collaborated with Charlie on a lot of stuff for about 12 or 13 years. Before his death last year, most of what I knew about him, I had heard directly from him, kind of an oral history. Most of the music or art I saw of his, he had just made it. We were, you know, always working on something new. Charlie was always engaged in what was going on now. So to kind of be able to look back on his career, particularly tonight, we're going to look at, you know, the early 90s as well as the late 70s. And I think you'll see some connections between the works in connection to the artists that you knew or to the communities that he was in touch with, how those relate, how his works relate to those. So without further ado, I'm going to join Joshua Barton, head of cataloging at MSU Libraries and zine librarian, while we take a quick look at Queer Magnolia. Thanks, Josh, for being with us today.
Yeah, happy to be able to join and talk about Charlie's stuff.
Well, let's look at some of these. What do you have on hand?
Yeah, well, we can start with the first one. So we've got numbers 39 through 50 of Queer Magnolia, and there's one or two issues missing in that run. So here's number 39, and laid out landscape style, but it's still like this half page, like a pretty conventional format for a zine, right? Just like a single 8.5 by 11 sheet of paper folded over, and then however many pages you want to make, that's how many you stack together and staple. But he would use some interesting folding techniques. So it's not just an 8.5 by 11 sheet of paper folded over, but you've got this kind of inset, the margins inset here slightly, so that they're bound together off center, the two pages, but then they work out to a regular half page size zine, and then he lays the cover out landscape style. So you can see like the personal touches, and it is consistent across the issues, I think, like where you see his handwriting, that's pretty identifying, whether it's like the big cursive like paint lettering of the title, or the handwritten with pen subtitle here, like moving memorial issue. There's a lot about death and loss here. Friends that go unnamed that are apparently gone, which seems to come up frequently for him. Mm-hmm. it's dated March 1991, and I think these issues run through 91, maybe to 93. Some of them go undated, so it's a little hard to know when exactly they're coming out. But a lot of them look like they could have been created at the same time, because there's common themes that come up. But, you know, like I said, he does a lot with the collage, with the co-optation of images from elsewhere. Nothing is really presented graphically straightforward across cover to cover. Like, you know, you start out landscape on the cover, and then you've got this poem and interfiled through these black lines here about American flags fading to the cover of piss yellow. And then you've got this stolen image from somewhere, some like medieval angel. And then you're back to landscape, just anti-war stuff that was happening at the time. Of course, this is like the first Gulf War era, March 1991. So it's just like they're just lifted and presented here to stand on their own without commentary. And then like some of the images like turned around, right? So it could have been like that this was all taken from the same source, but he's like flipping things around. And then you've got some, you know, some porn thrown in for good measure, window advertisements, Day of the Dead altar. And then you've got in the margins, I guess here, continuations of the themes from the poem on the first page.
Yeah.
And then on the back, just like redaction until it like it leaves this sentence about cynicism here, just lifted from a book, who knows what book. So that's number 39. We keep this stuff as safe as we can, right? Like,
yeah,
acid-free labels and these sleeves and everything. And then number 40, there's some similarities. This doesn't look like his handwriting. This looks like a to-do list or something, or a job ad that somebody pasted somewhere that Charlie must have lifted. You got like this flashy piece of paper stapled to the top of the issue, and then you've got flipped upside down a poem of his. This one is cool because you've got a lot of stuff happening as you turn the pages, but then there's this continuous poem that runs across the top margin. What he liked best about, and it goes on, never clarifies who he is. But you see here, living in Michigan, was the feeling that most of America was exactly like this, for better or for worse. Mostly worse. No false sense of security here. What he disliked most was people cutting down trees. So from the very beginning to the very end, you've got this poem that runs across the top margin, but then lots of other things happening on the way there, like more collage happening, more juxtaposition, stealing images from places, a standalone poem about somebody named John, and maybe this is John here, I don't know.
That's a really interesting portrait of Charlie on the top right there.
Yeah.
It's almost just
like a playing card or something.
Yeah, and it's just not a common expression really for him.
Mm-hmm. The face of a building. And then like another handwritten snippet here. Another poem. And more magazine clippings. More magazine clippings. And so you've got this poem that runs across the top that I already pointed out. And this phrase, what he disliked most was, and it's the poem actually goes over to the next page, but you could take it to be connected to the word AIDS down here. And this this man here on his deathbed. So it's like it's doing double duty here, that phrase. It's just like, I mean, there's a lot of thought that goes into this, right? Like, it's like very much composed, each issue of the zine. I guess I would skip ahead a few issues for the next one, but I just want to show you the cover of number 41 because I think it's hilarious. Where you've got like this angel from heaven reaching down to give a little pinch. And this is, I think, just like a lot of clippings from elsewhere. Very minimalist on this one. Again, with the interesting folding here, where you've got like wide pages, narrow pages.
Almost like a animated flip book too, with that little diving character.
Yeah, yeah. So these two issues, this is number 49 and number 50, go together. Something was going on, I don't know what, medically for Charlie at the time. And I'm not sure what the dates are here. This sometime in the fall of 1991, perhaps. Because this one.
He had like I think it was an eye surgery, and that was like his only medical procedure he really had done in his adult life. But yeah, he said it was expensive.
Yeah, well, it's documented here. Okay. the expense. And that's why it's interesting. Yeah, I mean, that is the context there. If this is like the only like significant engagement he had with medical intervention. It was obviously impactful because he did two zines about it, or at least two zines where it figures in prominently. The pre-op issue here, there's, I mean, clearly a lot of body stuff right off the bat. Some images from elsewhere. And this, here we've got like this fuller page screen print with a poem. Scrawled across what appears to be a print of Lenin's face. I'm not sure. Yeah, it must be Lenin, right? And then some of his original text there. This one seems a little more austere than some of the other issues. But it was just knowing that this next issue is coming up, which is just like kind of like playing collage with his medical statements, like his bills that he got. It seems significant that he's like mentioning that there's some kind of operation on the horizon when he put this issue out. And then this issue where, yeah, I mean, he turns his medical bills into art. We've got, it's basically just an itemized statement of what he was charged for the operation. Some kind of image that I can't quite make out. And it's bound like another one that we looked at earlier, the wide pages and the narrower pages. So you've got a poem dropped in the middle. What looks like a band photo or something drops in the middle over here. And then you don't get to the title and the number until the end, the post-op issue. Now these next two aren't necessarily pairs, but I like them together. This is number 42 and number 51. And this, I think, is the house on Magnolia. I could be wrong.
I think it is, yeah.
But of course, the zine is called Queer Magnolia. So, you know, the residence he was at was the part of the namesake for the zine. And so here's like an actual photographic print of the house. And this one, again, like changing up the layout. So you've got these quarter-sized sheets stapled going the long way. Another image of him that looks like it maybe came from the same. I don't know. It looks like it came from a film or something. This is what I mean when I was mentioning earlier how you can get clues as to which pieces of these are Charlie's original words and text that was lifted from elsewhere. So when you see typography like this versus the electric typewriter type, that's, I think this seems more likely to be his original language. Whereas this block of text and this block of text look like they were lifted from elsewhere. And then another block of text that was probably from elsewhere. I don't know, but I don't think Charlie like really did much with computers. Do you know?
No, I mean, you know, just used it at the library to check things out a little bit, but no,
so he had to, like some of this creative layout, this creative graphical work that he's doing is in this issue in particular. There's just some like really interesting things happening, like where you're having these large words that, like, I mean, I don't imagine he would have like typed them out and printed them and cut them and pasted them in, right? Like they're probably lifted from some other source, like just razor glue and tape to put this stuff together.
It looks really cool. Makes this issue stand out a lot, and I have no idea how he did it.
Yeah. So I like this one together with number 51 here, the last issue that we have, which is just, you know, in this small envelope with the handwritten title numbering and date on it, which when you open it is just a photographic print of a plant. And I don't know, like, maybe it's just like, you know, the pinkish siding in both photos, but they seem like a good pair to me.
And this 51 is the last issue.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. It's a good ending.
Yeah, and you know, who knows if Queer Magnolia continued after that. Gosh, like, who knows if it started before number 39? I don't even know.
Yeah.
Like number 39 is the earliest that we have.
If anyone's watching this and they know, if they have more information than us, we've tried reaching out and finding more information, and you know, we're just kind of beginning to archive all of Charlie's work. So get in contact with me or the MSU Special Collections. We want to see the full selection if there's more. So you also have a couple other titles from Charlie. Queer in Minneapolis is a really cool one.
Yeah, I like that one a lot. You had mentioned earlier, he's with a lot of these issues of Queer Magnolia, he's clearly trying to create a work of art. But then you've got this one issue where it's just like a house show review. Queer Minneapolis, which I have here. Is more along the lines of that issue, where this is just like kind of like a day-by-day diary of a trip that he took to Minneapolis, I think in November 1994. And you know, he's there performing, hanging out with people. It really is like a diary, some of it quite poetic.
What really stood out for me is the photos.
Yeah.
And also there's a, oh, I didn't catch that in the digital scan.
That's cool. Yeah, you got this piece of loud fabric attached here, like gold screen printing on some pink fabric. And then these, yeah, color prints from the trip. So Charlie performing with, he talks about this in the issue, performing with this guy, a cellist who did like some, I don't know what you would call it, like non-traditional use of the cello. Like getting feedback, amplified feedback out of it. And Charlie himself and some of the other characters that figure into some of the stories here. This image here with the glitter being thrown at the camera. I can't remember if it's in this issue or elsewhere where he talks about, so there's the filmmaker, Jack Smith, I think, who is a name in the underground scene. I'm not as familiar with him, but Charlie was apparently close with him. And after he died, he had some of his ashes, and so there's some of Jack Smith's ashes intermixed with glitter that he would throw about at shows.
I did not know that detail. That's amazing.
Yeah, and another image there of Charlie performing. Some drawings. And just a lot of text about, this is a writer that he's eulogizing here, whose name escapes me, like a kind of gritty mystery writer. And you'll notice the picture there matching the picture on the wall back here.
Oh, wow.
Another one here called Montgomery Clift Was Queer, and then you open it up and it has the alternate title, or New York Journal. Another journal documenting his travels and engagement with like other creatives, and this one in New York City, also in 1994. And so that's all this is. It's like talking about who he hooked up with, what kind of music they were listening to, what shows they went to. You've got some more fabric. So unlike Queer Magnolia, this is more, I don't know, a conventional way of doing things in zines, like, you know, like personal zines or per zines for short, where it really is just kind of like, this is what I'm doing. Like, you know, there's this kind of dumb parallel that people used to draw between zines and blogs. But when you see zines like this, it kind of makes sense why people would think about there being a parallel there. But this is interesting because it's, you know, it's Charlie and his associates. And of course, you know, he spent a lot of time in New York as well as Lansing and had a long history with all kinds of important things happening in New York in the late 70s. So when he's going back there and talking about happenings there, he knows what he's talking about.
You know, when you sometimes when you look back at an artist's archival work, it's, you know, official album releases and, you know, actual DVDs that you can find online. And Charlie was one of those artists who maybe kind of similar to how we document ourselves in modern times, where we just kind of put something out and, you know, tell our story in the moment and then, you know, keep creating and making something new. And, you know, what I mean is that when you're saying it's kind of a personal zine, so, you know, it's almost like, it's almost maybe like a status update for Charlie in 1994. And I do feel from his film from 1978, Against Nature, you know, it's almost like his Snapchat reel or something. You know, it's just a little 10 seconds here on this street, 5 seconds in this room. Here, you know, it's, here's what I made for breakfast is like a part of it, you know. Here's my bedroom. And I just think that's pretty cool. And how, you know, I think he almost, I don't think he thought of it as, you know, worthless or something, but he just didn't talk about it very much. And it's, you know, it's out there, you know, he had the foresight to drop it off at the library, thankfully. But, you know, we found Against Nature on a reel, in a reel case, what do you call that, on film, mm-hmm. in his belongings after he passed away. And his roommate Jake got it digitized. And so, you know, now we have these digitized too. And we're kind of just, you know, I'm kind of hoping that, you know, we're doing this on his birthday, and maybe every year we can kind of see what else we can kind of pull together that's out there and represent it to the people who care about his art and music.
Yeah. In some ways, what Charlie was up to with zines was what a lot of zinesters were up to as well. I think it's fair to draw those parallels to social media of now. Though I think, you know, with Charlie and with the other zinesters, you know, you're having to create the whole package for it, right? Like, there's a lot more being communicated than just like the words that you're saying or like posing for a picture. But there's this whole package that you're having to put together that has its own, like each aspect of it has its own kind of meaning and expression about who you are and who you're trying to connect with. I mean, I wonder to what extent Charlie thought of these as means for connection versus means for just expression. You know, how much he cared about just like producing and getting them out to the world, out into the world, versus how much of a feedback loop he wanted. I mean, it's clear from some of the stuff that we have of his that there was some correspondence with other zinesters. There was like a zine box that these people from Texas put together. It was kind of like, it looked like an idea that never really got off the ground, right? Like where you would like sign up as a participating artist and you would submit a zine. All the other participating artists would submit a zine, and then everybody that was a participating artist would get a box of everybody's zines that was a participant. And so Charlie had one in there, and he got a box of a bunch of zines that, you know, other participants had created, and we got that box and cataloged them all. So I mean, that was one example where there was like exchange happening, right? And he's putting his address on these and like saying that they're free on all the issues of Queer Magnolia. You know, there's the address on Magnolia Street on there, like kind of inviting correspondence. But yeah, you know, I just wonder to what extent he thought of these as like a way to build a creative network, a subcultural network, and like make those contacts, or if it was more like, this is like me just doing art, this is what I do, you know?
It's very cool. Well, Joshua, thanks for digging all this stuff out of Special Collections so we could take a look at it for the first time digitally. And yeah, I really appreciate your time, man.
Yeah, you bet, AJ. Glad to do it. Thanks.
Thanks again to Joshua Barton, MSU Libraries, Robin Theater. Before we begin the film broadcast of the evening, Against Nature, I want to show you a couple little items that go along with the film. So what we have here is the only VHS copy of the film. And that's titled the 1991 psychedelic video version. Charlie made this version by filming the movie with a camcorder, because originally he had the film reel and the audio separate, and there's specific instructions on how to marry the two. So here they are. And I followed those instructions preparing the film tonight, and the original audio is on this cassette here. So the first minute of the film is dark, so just hang in there for that. The music kind of builds up, and then the film starts. Those are the instructions. So I hope you enjoy. We're not going to have any sort of discussion or anything afterwards. So I just hope you enjoy the film and this look at Charlie Nash as a filmmaker.